Table, you may have gotten a copy of our golden rule handout sheet. you're free to take one home with you. So, although in some sense the religions are timeless, they also have a place historically, and we decided that we would do these in chronological order, more or less. So we're going to be starting with the oldest first, and then proceed to the newer, younger religions. And so, without further ado, I think we will just introduce Govinda Dasi, who is here from the Hindu tradition. She's a member of the ISKCON Radha Krishna Temple in Plainfield, New Jersey. And she's going to be giving some information about Hinduism. Now, shall I put on the, on the buttons?
Yes,
I think
so.
Yeah.
So, hello, everyone.
Hello.
I'm very grateful to my dear friend Brandi for giving me this opportunity to come and join here. And thank you all very much to be here listening to us. So I will begin a Vedic and Hindu perspective on the golden rule. And that is one earth, our home. I think I'm coming briefly with solid in the sky. So the basic Vedic aphorism for this is Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, which means Vasudha means earth, and Kutumba means one united family. And as we see, what is the basis of a family or a home? We say there are two main principles. One is that we seek protection and welfare to all, and the other one is that the common interest of maintaining peace and happiness in the family or the home. So the same principle, we consider the golden rule, one earth, one united home, as depicted in this picture. The golden rule is based on this principle, which is written on the top. It's called Jivadaya, which means compassion and empathy to all. And Krishna, which means praising the names of the Lord. And that itself is Dharmasar, which means the essence of every religion. So based on that, this idea that earth is our home, and the residents or the inhabitants of this home are depicted here, starting with the aquatics, the trees, the birds, and the worms, and the reptiles, and the four-legged animals, and finally all of us, the human beings, the different forms, and different personalities. And the foundation for this home, as understood in the Vedic literature, is the law of karma. It can also be said in other words as what goes around comes around, or reap as yourself. So that is. And the idea is that the Vedic literature teaches our brotherhood for one big united family, which comes from one of the main scriptures, Bhagavad Gita, where the Lord Himself says that I am the seed giving father to all living beings, I am the life of all that lives. I am seated in everyone's heart, as the, and then he advises us to see every living being as my eternal spiritual spark. Mm-hmm. And I'm showing that a little bit in the form of this picture, where you can see the spiritual unity among the diversity. And that spiritual unity is that we are all spiritual sparks coming from one father. Mm-hmm. And that's how the Vedic literature sees the unity, encourages the unity, and this is the golden rule, which is also described in one of the epics, Mahabharata. It says that this is the sum of the duty. Do not do to others what would cause pain if done to you. And how do Hindus practice this golden rule? Generally, we are advised in the scriptures to start from the self, from your own self, and try to practice and imbibe some of these qualities, starting with ahimsa, which is not only non-violence, but also no distress to others, respect to all life, tolerance for diversity, mercy and compassion, self-control, mind control, humility, our Father. So we, this is like a on-the-spot prayer to practice this golden rule. And I would like to sing this prayer, and please feel free to follow the English translation. So this goes like this. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah. May everyone be happy. Sarve Santu Niramayah. May everyone be healthy and free from disease. Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu. May everyone experience the good, the auspicious. Mahakashit Dhubhad Bhave. May everyone be free from suffering. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. O dear Lord, our Father, please engage us all in your service so we may love one another. So this is a simple demonstration of the golden rule that is practiced by Hindus in a very, this very common prayer. Namaste. Thank you very much.
Now we'll learn a little bit more from the Jewish tradition as practiced by Lynne.
So I just want to point out we have a golden rule chart. This is a wonderful teaching opportunity. Just take a picture and then you can take all these religions with you. So we encourage you to take a photo of that.
We have so many people here, I think we may not have enough copies of the handout. Taking a picture of this would cover most of the, everything that's on the handout.
Yeah. And some religions we have not covered today. We limited ourselves to 6 minutes of time. So unfortunately, with the sun pouring down from the heavens, you can't really see this. This is the Jewish golden rule. So it is that you treat others. So I can't even read it from there. What is hateful to you, do not do to your fellow person. This is the entire law. All the rest is commentary. And this is from the Jewish Talmud. This is the most important law, that we treat each other with kindness and respect, right? What else is there?
Yes.
Okay. So Judaism is about from 6000 BC, the late 6th century, before the Common Era. We are the oldest monotheistic religion. One God, which you can see here, we cannot take the name of the Lord in vain, so we do a hyphen. So in Judaism, we don't spell out the name God. We would not do G-O-D. There's a hyphen in respect to the Lord. Kings David and Solomon, you may be familiar with the Old Testament and the Bible, united Israel in 1000 BC and built the temple in Jerusalem, which you should know was subsequently destroyed by the Babylonians in 600 BC. They marched all the Jews to Babylon, which is basically Iraq. And then we built it, but then the Romans in 70 AD came and destroyed our temple again. So we no longer have the temple in Jerusalem. The Torah is the Hebrew Bible. It's the Old Testament. It was given to God in the Bible by Moses. He went up to, I guess it was Mount Sinai, and got the Ten Commandments. The Torah's supplemental oral tradition is that Jewish people later came, rabbis and other sages, and they translated what the Bible meant, and its oral traditions, which is now recorded. That is called the Midrash and the Talmud. Five books of Moses, you may be familiar with, tells the Genesis, the beginning of life, to including the Exodus when Jews were freed from Egypt and marched to Israel. Five books of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with the Old Testament. Jews don't agree with one another, right? So we have a lot of branches, a lot of sects. And then we differ by like how we follow the Bible or not follow the Bible, different traditions and interpretations. So humanistic Judaism, you may not have heard of, this is a branch that is more secular and more humanistic than traditional followers. The most strict would be Orthodox Judaism, Haredi, and modern Orthodox. So those are two different branches. Conservative, I grew up conservative, but then I raised my children Reform, and so Reconstructionist is more modern. So you can explore this, just Google it, and you can see that there's different ways of interpreting the Bible and reflecting your own Judaism. Jews are an ethno-religious group. You can be Jewish or you can convert to Judaism. Our world population is about 15 million, less than 1% of the total population. So that's 0.2%. That's like less than 1% of the total population. We lost 6 million Jews. You should know that number from the Holocaust. This is something, I lost my relatives in Belarus, in Ukraine. My relatives are gone. And of course, you should know the Germans also killed thousands of gypsies. The gypsies actually were the first to go, intellectuals, gay people, and people with disabilities. 47% of all Jews today live in Israel, and 39% live in U.S., Canada, and of course, diaspora, there's Jews all over the world. Major holidays, and we have lots of holidays, but the most important holidays are not Hanukkah. So, start with the five books of Moses. We read the Bible throughout the year. Every week at synagogues, we read the Bible. Yom Kippur is our holiest day, a day of fasting and atonement, where we atone for our sins, and we ask God for another year of life. And then Passover is very important because it's when Jews, for 40 years, wandered the desert. This is what the Bible says, and we landed in Israel. So that's important. So I'm going to leave you with the other important tenet of Judaism, which is tikkun olam, repair the world. I think all of you are the kind of people, here you are, you want to learn about other religions, so that I know that you have empathy, that we do things to help each other. So, repairing the world, you can work in anti-bias, charity, community service, interfaith, which is what this group is doing, helping low-income people. The list goes on and on. So we ask that we together repair the world, do something for somebody else. So questions after, and now we're going to.
Okay. I think no doubt the audience is already familiar with the general outlines of Christianity. Today we've asked Rebecca Erickson to provide some insights on a particular denomination from the that started during the Protestant Reformation, and it has some particular significance to those of us here in the Delaware Valley, that is the Quaker faith.
I'm not sure I have a full 5 minutes to talk, because it is a Christian tradition, this is a Christian congregation here, so although it's chronologically after Judaism, Quakers didn't come to be until the mid-1600s, under the sort of inspiration of George Fox. And there were a lot of radical Protestant religions cropping up around the same time, Puritanism, and just a lot. Something in the air for them. And the main, we don't have a creed, we don't have a written belief system, but the inner life without a God in every man was Penn's main focus and idea. So we are very stripped down, we're very simple. We have no clergy, no hierarchy, no creed, no ritual except meeting for worship when we gather in silence and people speak if they're moved to do so. No confirmation. No baptism. We're very simple. And you can't quite read that, so I'll read off the screen. So that's Luke. Do to others as you would have them do to you. So you all know a version of the Golden Rule, and the language depends on what Bible you're using. George Fox, the Bible is very important to early Quakers, but it wasn't the same as it would be for, say, Puritans, who thought, this is the word of God, it's laid it all out, we're done, this is it. George Fox thought that experience of God or of Christ and salvation was available to anybody, whether they lived before Jesus, never heard of Jesus, you know, Native Americans, and that probably was the one belief that made Puritans and others so mad at Quakers that they locked them up all the time. So I just thought it was important to say that even when you believe the golden rule and it's key to your faith and your practice, that we all don't live up to it. And even William Penn kept slaves. And he was a very good Quaker and a very important Quaker and wrote a lot of really wonderful things, but he was a slaveholder. So we had many Quakers, but very important John Woolman from Cherry Hill, New Jersey, who spent his ministry and traveled around encouraging Quakers to not be slaveholders and to become abolitionists. So I value him a lot and I wanted to push him in there. So we've evolved a lot. It's been 350 plus years. So Quakers can describe themselves as Christians, theists, universalists, pantheists, non-theists. It really depends on the person. And different meanings have different personalities, I would say. But the underlying principle of unity and that of God in every person and waiting in the light to find that unity is universal, I would say, for all.
So about 6 centuries after the start of Christianity, the religion of Islam arose in Arabia and spread extensively during the ensuing centuries. We're pleased to have Eman El-Badawi from the Muslim Center of Greater Princeton here to provide us with some background.
Thank you for having us here. Happy to be here. Monotheistic religion, it's a belief in one God and Muhammad is the prophet. And within the Islamic tradition, if we go back to the golden rule as depicted here on this poster, it says, love for your brother what you would love for yourself, which seems to be the common theme today. And the question is, how do you do that? How do you do that in a separate place? We've heard from the Hinduism. I wanted to give you a little bit of background to show you how in Islam you achieve that, how it is prescribed to you. So Islam in Arabic means peace, literally. There are about 1.8 million Muslims worldwide. So for those of you who think you have never met a Muslim, probably not the case. The five pillars of Islam are the tenets in the faith. Is the Shahada, which is a declaration of faith, the Salah, which is establishing prayers 5 times a day, giving of sadaqah, which is charity, sawm, which is fasting during the month of Ramadan, and a pilgrimage called the Hajj. And these follow teachings in the book, the Holy Quran, but they also follow prophetic advice from the books of Hadith and Sunnah. So when you think about the golden rule, love for your brother what you love for yourself, how do you do that? So Muslims are prescribed these 5 pillars to establish the oneness of God, to pray 5 times a day. It is very difficult for a person who prays truly 5 times a day to establish a prayer, a connection to your Creator, and then go and sin right after. It's very difficult to do that if you've managed to establish a proper connection in that prayer. Giving of charity, the idea that you take care of those that are less fortunate. Sometimes we as humans need to formalize that. If it doesn't come from within you, if the opportunity isn't created around you, it has to be given to you formally. So Muslims are instructed formally to give in charity. And there's something transformative about that. I think we can all appreciate there's something very transformative about that. The idea of fasting during Ramadan. Many people imagine it as a starvation fast. But it is actually an exercise in self-discipline to prevent yourself from what is normally lawful. For 30 days, it does something to you. It calms you down. It allows you to connect a little bit closer to your Creator. And then you want to give in charity more. You want to pray more. And so the idea of fasting is very regenerative and very self-disciplining. And the pilgrimage to Mecca is literally sort of you gathering with 1.8 billion people just like yourselves, feeling very small in an area that we are all praying, doing the same movements, and it's the idea of humility and togetherness and unity. So Muslims greet each other by saying, As-salamu alaykum. If you listen to that word, salam, that's the word Islam, and salam, that means peace. So I would say to you, As-salamu alaykum, and I'm wishing peace upon you. And your response to me would be, Wa alaykum as-salam. Can we try that? So As-salamu alaykum.
Wa alaykum as-salam.
And it's nice, strangers greeting each other with peace, because we are establishing that that is my intention for this encounter, a peaceful one. I'm not sure if you can see the pictures, but I wanted you to just appreciate from this slide. Pilgrims come in many different shapes and sizes and colors. Some with a scarf, some without. Some are Asian, some are Arab. Many times people think that the largest population of Muslims are in the Arab countries. And that couldn't be further from the truth. If I were to ask you all, which is the most populous Muslim country? Yes. Bravo. Yes. It's an Asian country. So it's very interesting. So in accordance with various verses from the Quran or sayings of the Prophet, I wanted to read a couple of these. And these are sort of the idea that love for your brother what you love for yourself and how the instructions come in many different forms. So a Muslim is considered a believer if they desire for their brother what they would desire for themselves. So we've established that act to be actual. This is how you are considered a believer. A Muslim should not do evil to those who do evil unto them, but rather deal with them with forgiveness and kindness. I think this is quite similar to a lot of religions, forgive. Woe to every slanderer and backbiter. Talk about slander and backbiting in a lot of religions. Do you know what is better than charity and fasting and prayer? It is keeping peace and good relations with people as quarrels and bad feeling destroy mankind. So again, we have elevated the relationship between people to be higher than charity and fasting, even though those two are part of the five tenets of the faith. The most honored are those who forgive when they have power over others and love thy neighbor. So Muslims are multi-ethnic, we talked about that. And the idea that if God wished, God would have created us all as one, that the diversity was the plan. Next. So the Quran's verse saying, saving one life is like saving all of mankind. I think this is very similar to Judaism, it's very similar to a lot of religions. The values call for integrity towards all forms of life. You are responsible for everything on this earth. Ihsan is excellence in faith, and that is the goal of every Muslim, is to attain Ihsan. This was a last saying that I thought I would share with you by Ali ibn Abi Talib. He said, hate no one no matter how much they wrong you. Live humbly no matter how wealthy you become. Think positively no matter how hard life is. Give much even if you've been given little. Keep in touch with the ones who have forgotten you, and forgive those who have wronged you, and do not stop praying for the best for those love you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm grateful for my Muslim friends, particularly my cardiologist, who keeps my heart going. And I suspect that probably a lot of us here have at least someone in the medical community who is of Islamic background. So we appreciate the effort certainly they've made to keep us all healthy. So a more recent addition to the family of religions is the Baha'i faith. Started in 1844 in Persia. And my name is Jay Tyson. I am a member from the Baha'i community of Hamilton Township. We see here on the left the picture of the Baha'i house of worship in Wilmette, Illinois, just north of Chicago. We have houses of worship like this in each of the continents, and now a few individual countries where there are significant Baha'i populations. And on the right, copy of the, at least one version of the Golden Rule found in the Baha'i writings. If thine eyes turn toward justice, choose thou for thy neighbor what thou choosest for thyself. Like many of the religions, you may find the Golden Rule given in a couple of different forms because it is so significant. But this is one form that you find it in the Baha'i writings. So a little bit about the Baha'i faith. The main principles start with the oneness of God, which I think is shared with virtually every religion. And the oneness of humankind, recognition that God is creator of everyone. So we need to treat everyone as a creation of God. The oneness of religion, we recognize that the similarity is not simply a similarity in ethics, but is actually, they're similar because they come from the same source. There are, of course, differences because of the time and circumstances under which they were revealed, but we believe that they are connected with each other through, among other things, they're connected through prophecies. And Christians are familiar with the prophecies from the Old Testament that link to the New Testament. Recently are perhaps cognizant of the prophecy from the Zoroastrian religion that drove the wise men to seek Jesus at the time of his birth. And so those are some examples of religious connection through prophecy. Another important principle is the equality of men and women and the harmony of religion and science. This is particularly important in this modern age where science has become, has grown so much, expanded so much. We have decision-making through a process of consultation, and that principle means that we are able to operate the religion entirely based on group decision-making. Because of that, it's not necessary for us to have any individual clergymen or people of in the clerical order. It's all through group decision-making. Independent investigation of truth is one of the Baha'i principles, which is to say that each person should decide for himself or herself as to their religious path and not automatically follow what their parents have told them. And the establishment of universal peace through the strengthening of international law. We believe that this is the age in which mankind is coming together. This needs to be recognized not only on a spiritual basis, but also on an institutional basis for the elimination of war. The picture on the right there is the shrine of the forerunner of the Baha'i faith, who was known as the Bab. Because of his modern teachings, in 1850, he was executed. His remains in 1899 were brought to the Holy Land and interred in Mount Carmel, and this shrine was built around it. It becomes a place of pilgrimage for the Baha'is. Picture on the left there is the main administrative building of the Baha'i faith, also in Haifa, Israel, called the seat of the Universal House of Justice. This was an organization which the founder, Baha'u'llah himself, told us we should establish. And so it was finally established by election of Baha'is from around the world. It was first established in 1963, 100 years after the beginning of the Baha'i faith. It originated in Persia in the mid-1800s and has spread east and west since then. We now number about 8 million around the world. With national centers in 183 countries, so it is pretty much everywhere. However, one distinguishing feature about the Baha'i faith is there is only one denomination. It is not, you don't find different branches. And of course, for a religion whose primary theme is unity, it would make sense that it should stay united. The nature of the Baha'i scripture is that it is spiritually revealed. That is, it's not wasn't revealed through scholarship. So a few of the religions, Sikhism, Confucianism, the founders themselves said that they have studied what others have taught and they have put it together. So those are scholarly based religions. But most of the religions, Judaism, Hinduism, Islam, Christianity, the founders say that it was revealed to them. It was not something that they thought of or an exercise instead of. So those are the basics of my faith, and we look forward to any questions. And our final presentation is a Unitarian Universalist, Sharon Copeland from the Princeton Unitarian Universalist Church will provide details. And,
thanks. It's great to see all of you here. What a great group this morning. So to give you a little background about Unitarian Universalism, our beliefs are very diverse and inclusive, and we don't have like one creed, one theology. And the most important thing coming out of that is that you belong, that we really have an emphasis on inclusivity. Although we came from liberal Christian traditions, like Unitarians, Universalists were in Europe, and in the 1700s, the Universalists were established in the Americas, and in 1825, the Unitarians were established in the Americas, and the two merged in 1961, so that's pretty recent, to become Unitarian Universalists. But the background of these religions is that they were very much about the search for meaning and the search for truth and looking to many different ways to come to that. So we actually believe in many teachings based on many sources. You want to turn it? So we consider all of these things our sources. Direct experience, similar to the Quakers, and as Jay just said, respecting someone's own revelations, own discernment about spirituality. Wisdom from the world's religions, we love to study other religions and learn from that. Words and deeds of various prophets, including Jesus Christ as a prophet. Humanist teachings, which is a look to science, and spiritual teachings of Earth-centered traditions, like paganism. There are many, especially indigenous peoples, who use very Earth-centered approaches to sustaining the balance in our Earth, in our world, and in where they live. And we'd like to learn from that. And of course, Jewish and Christian teachings, which call us to love our neighbors as ourselves, as do these other religions. So, not having a creed, we do have covenants, and we have basically seven principles, which I know they're a little hard to see on this screen, so I'll try to quickly go through them. The first is the inherent worth and dignity of every person, including myself, because it's very hard to love your neighbor if you don't love yourself. So it's really important to become grounded in believing your own worth and having and claiming your own dignity. Justice, equity, and compassion in human relations, acceptance of one another, a free and responsible search for truth and meaning, the right of conscience, working towards world peace, liberty, and justice, and respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. So if you look particularly at 1, 2, 3, and 7, those are what contribute to our understanding of what the golden rule is. So coming from our sense of the inherent worth. together to sustain that interdependent web is really important. So for me, like the kind of the bottom line is that the golden rule for us as UUs is not so much a statement as it is a life practice. So this last slide tries to portray this is how we function. And actually, I became a UU because I was so interested in making sure what I believed and how I lived were aligned, that they were together. So we're right now working on an eighth principle that has to do with this math on racism and living accountably in our world. And so these are pictures of some of the things that we do, not only around that principle, but also you know, when it comes to caring for one another, like we work on things like food scarcity. When it comes to the LGBTQIA and advocacy for other oppressed peoples, or advocating for women's reproductive rights, or advocating for immigrants and refugees, these are all really important things to us, and we take action on them. The green sanctuary emblem right there, our congregation is a green sanctuary, meaning we passed a resolution and said all our practices in our buildings are going to try to contribute to a more sustainable earth. So we have solar panels on our church. We do we sort our garbage so that we can do composting. It's a real pain in the butt. We realize all of this contributes to how we live. So we try so hard to live our values and constantly practice that golden rule. And we also have something called Unity with Action New Jersey. So all of the congregations in New Jersey have come together for legislative ministry. So we literally do pay a lot of attention to the state laws and statutes, and you know, we will be advocates for areas that where we feel we need to take action to live out our understanding of the golden rule. That's pretty much
So I imagine that that may have generated some questions, and we've got another 15 minutes, I guess, here to for questions. See one in the back.
Yeah, real quick from each one. Is your children born into your faith, or is there some kind of initiate? Like we had the confirmation today. Is it something you go through adulthood, or is there? Are you born a Muslim?
So for each of the religions.
Yes, if you don't mind, real quick.
Okay.
Well. Of course, we have children born into UUism, but we also have many, many people who come to UUism, especially couples where they may be two different faiths, because since we embrace all traditions, all theologies, they find a very easy home there to negotiate and be a part of the congregation.
Thank you.
So in Islam, you definitely have people that are born into faith, but there are also a lot of converts and reverts. And the formality of that process is literally the confession of the faith, that there is only one God and Muhammad is the messenger. It's not followed by a baptism or a ritual of sorts. And then people then establish their prayers and the rest of the five.
Is there an age requirement?
Not at all.
No, okay.
So, and then there's also children are born. But at the same time, there has been a trend where people embrace Hinduism in the later part of their lives. And especially in the 70s, if you remember, the Hare Krishnas, they became one, and many people joined from all walks of life. So we have a ritual which where we train the kids and they get into the more regulated system. But that can be done at any stage of your life.
So in the Baha'i community, of course, we do have children who are growing up. We provide regular classes, which are not solely about the Baha'i faith, but they're about all religions. So they have a sense that, you know, the religion of God is all religions. At age 15, they are allowed to declare formally as Baha'is, but they are not required to, because, as I said, we believe in the independent investigation of truth. So some of the children will become Baha'is, but not all of them. And that that's perfectly okay.
So I was born Jewish, actually, in Trenton, New Jersey. My husband is Jewish. We raised our children Jewishly. They were born bat mitzvah at 13 years old, which is when they, you know, declare what they want their faith to be. Today, there is a lot of assimilation where a Jewish person will marry a non-Jewish person, and that person can take classes and convert to Judaism.
I'm a little shaky on this because my family's been Quaker for such a long time. I think it really comes down to a lot of people attend meeting, but they are not what we would call members of a meeting. And if you want to become a member of a meeting, which I guess is officially Quaker, there's kind of a clearness process. You would meet with members of the meeting and agree together that you are ready to be a member of a meeting, and then you're officially Quaker.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Or comments?
Or comments? Yes.
The gentleman's question raises something interesting that's essential, in my view, to the idea of really being a relationship. I have to sort of talk this out a little bit. We are all people of faith. Ideally, our faith is born of the confirmation of our heart and the conviction of our mind. And for the golden rule to be meaningful, we really need to act from that. We live in a world where much of the time, much of its population seeks to affirm their faith by bullying other people. And always when I see that, it makes me recognize that they do not really have faith, because if you have a confirmation in your heart, then you don't need to bully other people to get them to go along. You know? And really, you can't implement the golden rule if you're believing that the other person is an other, is not in the realm that you think is okay. You know, so in a sense, asking the question about do you accept the faith that you're born into, it raises the question of what some people call the birth model. The idea of truth is that it's universal, and it shouldn't depend on any accident of materiality. You know, I was originally born in one faith and then became another. But I think the challenge is for all of us is to know our own faith and be confident and confirm within our hearts so that we don't need to go to. And I guess I would ask you to speak to that. How do you encourage those of your faith to have this open-heartedness to other people in terms of their truth that then allows you to effectively practice the golden rule and not think about, well, how do I convince this person to think as I do? Or how do I stand away from them because they're not thinking as I do? Because it's a fundamental problem for right now. I mean, the greatest dilemma, of course, is if you happen to be of one particular political view and someone is not, then you believe, I want to go against this person, they're my enemy, which is completely incompatible with this universal reciprocity that the golden rule calls for, which our world depends on. We can't succeed as a world unless we truly follow the golden rule as a whole. So if you would speak to that, like how do you get people to be confirmed within themselves so that they don't feel that they have to go?
So this has been a concern of mine for 20 years. And so 20 years ago, I realized we are lacking empathy. There's an empathy deficit, that we walk in the shoes of others, that our children walk in the shoes of others, that we walk in the shoes of other people's religions. So we do have an empathy deficit. So we need, I think, an earlier age, and I'm an educator in New Jersey. I have with Rebecca together, we have a youth center where we teach children empathy starting in preschool. So we need to start younger because adults are here, but if we could teach empathy, and I researched this, I actually have written a book about, you know, coaching children to become. respectful and successful, we can do a better job of it. We don't start earlier because children see you're not my religion, you're not my skin color, you don't eat the lunch I have, you're wearing the wrong clothes, and all the immigrants that we have that we